down the street. I know she was excited about going to the beach.
Oh, yeah, I didn't see her since.
I'm gonna go fill up your closet.
Right, please.
She's doing good, but it's slow, whatever, yeah.
How about the water?
No, that's all right.
Okay, just let me know.
Well, yeah, we've been good, good, just like, you know, we're a little slow now.
Oh, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It's good to see all of you here today. I hope you're having a blessed morning.
So far.
I had the pleasure of watching another beautiful sunrise coming in today and just reminded me of the overwhelming beauty of God's love this morning, and it just warmed my heart to be able to come in and share today with y'all and to be able to see you today. And so I'm looking forward to spending this day with you. On the way of announcements, I would like to be able to get together with y'all and set a date for having a get together with the Nolanville UNC to go out to Mary Lynn and Kinder's bamboo farm.
So they're still wanting to do that with us?
They're still wanting to do that.
We're just waiting for a date?
Yeah, June is probably going to be better because it's already getting into the hundreds this week, so uh-huh. We don't want to wait till July. Sometime during the week would be a good day. I believe she said either Monday or a Friday would be the best. So if we can get some ideas, maybe after church, of when might be good for y'all, we can start putting together a date, and I'll be in contact with them, and we'll see what works out. We can work together on that.
Sounds good.
And the way of celebrations, you know, it's just been a blessed week for me. I have seen God. I spent some time in prayer, and I just felt Him talking to me about reaching out to somebody. And then the next morning, after spending that time in prayer one evening, the next morning, a friend from an old church who I hadn't talked to in a couple years gave me a call and told me that they met somebody who was apparently just out of jail. They were a recovering addict, and they needed somebody to talk to about dealing with that issue. And I just felt that was a real calling on me. So that's where I saw God's blessing in my life, was the opportunity to go and minister to them a little bit and develop a relationship and get to explore my calling some with them. And so I've been really blessed that way. Is there a way that you felt God working in your life this week, where you've seen Him bless you?
No one being called to be a blessing. To keep me in call a little bit. I was here at the church. It's like maybe Tuesday. And I was just coming in real quickly to do something. I walked out the door and was just standing right there. And he wanted to come in and rest. I couldn't stay, but I tried to stay calm. Everything I would say to him, do we have something to say back? So I still try to say calm. Well, bad, I was, you know, they've been told to do something. I was a little uneasy, but I tried to stay calm. But I know it'd been a good situation for you to, I guess, to talk about it.
We had a nice call.
He kept insisting he wanted to come in. I said, I just can't stay. I was thinking, I could really want to come in. But I just wouldn't. So I stayed out to the front.
I would have felt uneasy.
It's the second, uneasy. I guess the second time that I've been so I know it's sad to say that my family just wanted to come myself.
I think that's God's blessing that you're safe and that nothing happened.
I should tell you, he didn't have anything. Getting a drink, you know, if you just bought a drink or something and sat down, I'm sure they would let him stay there for all the minutes. So I said, where are you this right here? Yeah. He said he walked from Temple.
He walked from Temple?
That's what we told him. But anyway, I guess just that I could stay kind of calm and just, try to calm.
The Lord stilled your heart in that moment. I'm glad that he was with you.
Could you tell that he left when you got in your car?
Set up the keys, everything was inside right at the table here, and so I finally, we finally started walking off, and that's when I began to have my things and saw them. The
Lord was watching out after you.
And he probably nothing would have happened, but I guess just being a kid, I don't know that I could defend myself or anything like I used to, if something should have happened.
Being alone in the situation, you can't be too sure. So.
If you accepted what I was saying, you accepted that I had to do something.
You did the right thing.
It's a shame that things have gotten so that you can't trust someone and help someone like that, but it's too risky.
It's too bad we don't have someplace here.
You know, as much as I spent time down there all the time, nobody never came up or anything.
Are there any other ways that y'all have seen God bless you this week? Seeing the pictures of your babies, that's a wonderful blessing.
That was a big blessing. I'll show you after church. It's a wonderful blessing because it's kind of just drawing us closer to everyone, and it is.
How the children are making y'all a little bit closer knit again.
Yes.
That's wonderful. Are there any other ways that y'all see God working?
He's got me up every morning.
Amen. Got you up and got the coffee in your hand.
That's right.
Well, as we have begun this week talking about the community and faith, I want to share with y'all something. These connecting pieces that are used for fishing. I want y'all to remember that we are fishers of people. That's what God has called us to be. And these bracelets were made by youth to serve as a reminder of who we are as fishers of people.
Oh my goodness.
Now they're made with the connectors that are used on fishing lures and fishing weights.
Thank you.
So throughout this,
how
So throughout this series that we're doing, I would ask that if you can't wear it, but at least keep it with you as a reminder of who we are as a community and how these little connectors are all together, how they stay together as a community and what that means as we explore what it means to be part of the community in faith.
I got it on my wrist.
I don't know if I can or not.
For our birthdays and anniversaries, I know we want to celebrate with Bert and Jane.
Oh, yes.
They had their 54th, I believe it was.
Oh, my gosh.
Anniversary.
54?
Yeah, 54th wedding anniversary. So, very happy. I got to see them on Monday, or see Bert anyways on Monday. He's doing very well. And he told me to pass along his love to y'all and say that he misses you. We're just very happy for them, and we want to be in, or keep them in our prayers. They can celebrate many more years together.
Enjoy, you know, Jane has a very special way of praying. She can just, it just seems, you know, some people have it, it just seems to flow, and it's wonderful.
That's one of her spiritual gifts. Well, let's turn now to our call to worship. Our call to worship, we have an unusual day in this Sunday. I say unusual because many different days fall on today. It's Trinity Sunday. It's also Peace with Justice Sunday. And as it happens, Memorial Sunday fell on today as well. So in an effort to recognize each of those, we're going to use different parts of our worship to address each one of them. During our affirmation of faith, we're going to be doing the Nicene Creed from 880 instead of the Apostles' Creed this morning. But for our call to worship, we're going to do something from the Peace and Justice. It's a liturgy. The red R on there is, or actually it's not red on this one, but where it has the capital R, it's just the O Lord, deliver us. And we'll repeat that. From self-righteousness that will not compromise, and from selfishness that gains by the oppression of others, O Lord, deliver us. From the lust for money or prayer that drives to kill, O Lord, deliver us. From trusting in the weapons of war and mistrusting the counsels of peace, O Lord, deliver us. From hearing, believing, and speaking lies about other nations, O Lord, deliver us. From suspicions and fears that stand in the way of reconciliation, O Lord, deliver us. From words and deeds that encourage discord, prejudice, and hatred, from everything that prevents us from fulfilling your promise of peace, O Lord, deliver us. God of your goodness, give us yourself, for you are sufficient for us. We cannot properly ask anything else
to be worthy of you.
If we were to ask less, we should always be in want.
If you alone do we have all.
Amen. Now let us sing the refrain of Spirit of God. Alleluia. Come, Spirit, come. Alleluia. Come, Spirit, come. Alleluia. Come, Spirit, come. Alleluia. Come, Spirit, come. Our special prayer, if you would like to bow your heads with me as we recognize those in this day that we celebrate for Memorial Day and those who have passed away this week in tragic circumstances. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, before whom stand the living and the dead, we, your children, whose mortal life is but a hand's breadth, Lord, we give thanks to you for all those through whom you have blessed our pilgrimage, whose lives have empowered us, whose influence is a healing grace. We lift up thankful hearts for the dear friends and family members whose faces we see no more, but whose love is with us forever. We lift up thankful hearts for the teachers and companions of our childhood and youth, for the members of our household of faith who worship you now in heaven. We lift up thankful hearts for those who sacrifice themselves, our brothers and sisters, who have given their lives for the sake of others. We lift up thankful hearts for their families and loved ones who have sacrificed alongside with them, and those families and loved ones of all who have served, who have given of themselves willingly and selflessly, so that we, who are many, may be free to love you with our whole hearts. We lift up thankful hearts for our children who live in the threat of gunfire, who go to school and do not return home. Father, for their families and their loved ones, for their classmates, Lord, we lift up broken hearts. For their teachers and officers and other students, faculty, who have risen to the occasion to sacrifice themselves that there may be fewer casualties. We honor them, Lord, and we lift up thankful hearts, that we may hold them all in continual remembrance and ever think of them as with you in that city where gates are not shut by day, and where there is no night. We lift up thankful hearts, that we may now be dedicated to worship for a world where labor is rewarded, fear dispelled, and the nations made one. O Lord, save your people and bless your heritage. Day by day we magnify you and worship your name forever and ever. And let all God's people say, Amen. Our first hymn today will be How Great Thou Art, number 77 from your hymnal.
Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Let us turn to number 880 for the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. In his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen. What needs would we like to lift up this week in prayer?
That my medicine works to help me sleep.
Okay.
What other needs do we have this week? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly and gracious Father, we thank you for the way that you have loved us, Lord. We honor you, Lord, and we glorify you with our whole hearts. Father, we pray that your kingdom come on this earth and that your love be realized in the hearts of many. Lord, we ask your guidance on this mission that you have given us in this world, and that through us that you might bless all those that you put in our way, that we may become a true light for you, and that our hearts might be changed by relationship with you. Lord, we ask that you convict us of our sin, that you bring it to light, that we might be spared the eternal damnation to enjoy everlasting life with you. Lord, we ask that you change us to love, not to seek things of the flesh, Lord, but to seek things that are on high, the precepts of your ways. Lord, we know that you have all of our needs in the palm of your hand, and that we can trust that once we've given them to you, we have no need to take them back upon ourselves. And that though we may not see the answers in the time that we want, that you have already answered our prayers, Lord. That you will do it in your time, and you will do it according to your will. Lord, may you be blessed above all things. May your righteousness be seen in all ways. And may the love of Christ shine forth through us as we join in the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Forgive me, I didn't realize how cold that was. We've been running for so long. Our next hymn will be number 369, Blessed Assurance.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture, no words on my sight, angels descending, bring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, and happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above. Filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the many blessings that you have poured out on us. Lord, we ask that you bless these offerings that we come to you today with, and that you would take them to glorify your name, and that you would further your mission in this world. We ask that you multiply them, Lord, and that they just bring the name of Christ's glory in this world. In your name we pray. Amen.
Praise God from whom all
blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Our next hymn will be Rock of Ages, number 361.
Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flowed be of sin a double cure. Save from wrath and make me pure. Not the lay of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands. Could my zeal no rest thy nose, could my tears forever flow, all for sin could not atone.
To thee for grace fell.
Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to the cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. But I know no fountain of life, wash me, Savior, or I die. While I draw this fleeting breath, when mine eyes shall close in death, when I soar to worlds unknown, see thee on thy judgment throne. Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee.
Be seated, please. Our scripture today comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 42 through 47. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day they spent much time together in the temple. They broke bread from house to house and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In Acts, Luke dedicates just four verses worth of scripture to the event of Pentecost. Now, that's not to diminish the importance of the event, but instead it's to celebrate and focus on what resulted. And that was the emphasis of Luke's author. See, the kingdom of God had come. The Spirit of God was on humanity. And God, with people, had created the community of faith and sent them out into the world to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, when God created the church, that new kind of community was born. And with that kind of community, there are certain things that have to hold it together. There are principles and precepts, a glue, a kind of adhesive that has to bind it and hold it as one, something that's deeper than just the laws, the normal laws of safety. Now, when those precepts are no longer held to, when those principles are forgotten, and when that glue, that adhesive, it breaks, then those relationships sour. Those connections are lost. And that's when iniquity is given room to thrive in that community. And then things like in the community, tragedy, senseless tragedy, just tears them apart. And so they're left with questions, wondering, well, what went wrong? Whose fault was it? And what can be done to fix it? Or even, can it be fixed at all? But when Christ made that community of faith, that church, He gave them the supplies to keep that community connected. He gave them the precepts, the glue, to bind them as one and to cultivate that unity. And so we look at that first church and we ask them, you know, what it was that sustained them through that season of joy and growth. And we look at how we can apply that to our contemporary culture today. And Luke, in verse 42, says, excuse me, I don't have my notes today. I forgot them at home. I got here and they were sitting on my couch. Be patient with me.
Bless his heart.
Yeah. In verse 42, it says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Now, we'll discuss those practices later. The main takeaways that we want to look at here are the two words that they devoted. It was not it was not just a casual practice. It wasn't lackadaisical. It was something that they committed to. And the other word is themselves. They devoted themselves. They were responsible and accountable for participating. They didn't have to be browbeaten. They didn't have to be reprimanded by each other or forced by each other to show up. That was something very common in the other religious practices, that, especially in Judaism, that they were supposed to watch over their brother and to hold their brother accountable for paying attention to the law. That was something that was different in Christianity and the way. They became accountable for themselves. Verse 43 says, "Awe came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles." Now, Jesus doesn't call us into blind faith. In John chapter 10, the Jews were ready to stone Jesus. He had done many signs and wonders, but he called himself the Son of God. And so they said that was blasphemy. And he said, "If I don't do the works, don't believe a thing I say. But if I do the works, then you can believe I am who I say I am. But if you're not going to believe me for what I say, then at least believe me for the works that you see." He said, in this way, they would know that he was in the Father, and the Father was in him. See, in the same way, the people could see that the apostles were in the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit was in them. The people's eyes, they had the Holy Spirit in them as well. And their eyes were now open to the things of God. They can now receive the things of God, what they were blind to before. It takes the things of, or it takes the Holy Spirit to see those things. Often we have to give a little bit of faith in order for us to see his works. I guess a good word to describe that would be, our faith isn't blind, it's groggy. It has to be woken up a little bit. Kind of like getting the sleep out of your eyes. And once you do, once you believe in it, your eyes are awakened to it. And your world is opened. Verse 44 says, "All who believed were together and had all things in common." Now, they weren't they weren't hive-minded. They weren't a cult of personality. But the big thing that was done in Christ that unified them in his death and resurrection, and forgiving them and offering them eternal life, that big thing that was done far superseded all the small things that separated them. One of the meanings for all things in common, that's actually one word in the Greek text. It's koinonia. It's only used one time here in Acts, and it's used a few times by Paul elsewhere. It literally means fellowship, but it's not the casual type of fellowship. What it is, it's a sincere and profound investment and another spiritual and emotional well-being. Now, I've always had a little bit of trouble this screen's acting up on me. Verse 45 says, "They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need." Now, that doesn't mean that they would sell everything that they owned and enter into a commune in poverty. It doesn't mean that they just put everything that they had into a kitty and everyone just grabbed out of that as they needed. What it means is that through the change of heart that they were given in Christ through the Holy Spirit, it means that now they no longer used people to gain goods and money. Instead, they used their goods and money to bless people. When another was in need, they weren't slowed down by the conflict of whether or not they could go with or without something. They just gladly went without something in order to meet that person's need. Verse 46, we read, day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread from house to house and ate their food with glad and generous hearts. Now, it's impractical to think that everybody spent all day in the temple. Of course, most of them all had jobs to go to. They had to provide for themselves. But what they did is they made time regularly for worship. And that's more than just a once a day type or once a week type of thing. But they made it part of their daily routine, part of their daily practice. And they made time regularly for each other. See, the home becomes a sanctuary when the Holy Spirit fills it. 47, it says, after it says they ate in each other's homes with generous or sincere hearts, it says they praised God, they gave thanks, they lifted their voices and rejoiced, they sang songs, they prophesied. Verse 47 continues, and having the goodwill of all the people. See, at the formation of the church, there was no grief. There wasn't strife. There weren't any unmet needs. There wasn't any division or any divisiveness going on. They were in a season of joy, a season of just all around goodness. It was a honeymoon, if you will. Now, inevitably, pain came upon the church in the form of persecution, of poverty, in the form of divisiveness, in the form of heartbreak. But we must remember that it's just as important to praise God when we're under fire as it is when we're sitting on a boat fishing. 47 continues, and day by day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved, those who were being saved. God was working deep in their lives. The change was undeniable. The kingdom of God had arrived. And when you allow God to work deep in your life the way that they left the example for us to follow, then you and others will notice. And they'll be drawn to you. So, what was so different about these followers of the way? What was it that made them such a distinct and unique ambassadors of Christ? How did they cultivate such deep and cherished relationships between themselves and God and with each other? And how can we do the same in our lives? Well, in verse 42, Luke mentions four critical themes. He said that they devoted. You can interpret that committed, dedicated, consecrated themselves to teaching, fellowship, to breaking of bread, and to prayers. First is teaching. These were definitely people of the word. Not only did they study the scriptures, but they also got to learn from Jesus' closest pupils, his disciples. And being that close, it means that what they got was a gospel that wasn't detached from truth. Truth can sometimes be a difficult thing to swallow. But that conviction that we receive can also be what saves us from eternal hell. Now, Jesus talked about hell more than he did about heaven. It wasn't a pleasant subject. It's a very real place. Now, we have assurance of our salvation through our belief and our faith in Christ as our Savior. But iniquity, unrepentant, leads to sin. And sin, unchecked, becomes a pattern. Pattern sin leads to the degradation of the soul. And a degraded soul will deny Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. And that, brothers and sisters, will separate us from God. There's also one of the very practical teachings that they had. One that's still somewhat common today. I was very guilty of this myself at first. The Old Testament is commonly thought of as the law, and the New Testament as grace. Somewhat true. But it was a pastor friend of mine who was kind of a mentor who opened my eyes to the abundant grace that's available in the Old Testament. And one of the instances, a great example of that, is the story of Jonah and Nineveh. I say Jonah and Nineveh because the whale was actually a very small part of the story. But see, when Jonah went to prophesy in Nineveh, once he finally made it there, the whole city repented. And God relented, and the whole city was saved. It was an amazing story of grace, even though Jonah wasn't very happy about it. He wasn't a happy camper. But nonetheless, it's a story of God's grace. And just one of many out of such a large book of scripture. That same pastor, he asked his professor, the one who opened his eyes to the Old Testament. He asked him, so if there's so much grace in the Old Testament, then what was the need for sacrifices? He said, those were for human benefit. Well, okay. Well, see, people had a hard time comprehending forgiveness without some kind of act involved. They couldn't comprehend forgiveness without that's contingent upon confession alone, without having to pay some kind of penitence. So when what Christ did on the cross, when he finished it as the penultimate sacrifice, no more sacrifices were needed. He was it. He said, it's finished. This was a new teaching, even for the ones that were teaching it. So they spent all day in the temple and in the speaking areas teaching. It says in the text, day by day. And so we have that same teaching in our Bibles for us to study day by day. Number two is fellowship. Now, contrary to many popular country songs, we're not built for lonely. The love and adoration of God is very much a corporate affair. It's in fellowship that we grow, that we're encouraged. It's in fellowship that we sing songs and share our testimonies and edify one another. I struggle with filling out forms because a lot of them ask for your marital status. Now, I'm not married. But when they ask you if you're married or unmarried, that's fine. I just check unmarried, no problem. But when it says, are you married or single? Well, I'm confused. Because I'm not married, but I'm not single either. I am spiritually, emotionally, physically, and existentially connected to all believers and to my Savior through the death and resurrection of Christ, through the Holy Spirit. As a kid, I hated going to parades. It just drove me nuts. I was a short kid anyways. Now I'm tall, but I was always shorter than the rest of my class. And so all I did was stare at backs, to put it nicely. And it was just a boring day for me. It was hot. Lubbock was just hot. And my parents loved it, so I got dragged out to all the parades. Now, the only time that I ever had fun was whenever a military unit came down the road. I always squeezed to the front so I could watch them. They were tall and they were short. They were of every race and every ethnicity. They had different family backgrounds, different cultures. They had different hopes and dreams. They had different personalities. They had different tones of speech. They had different accents. They were all one color, green or blue. When they took a step, you heard one step as they marched. When they turned their head, it was all one movement in unison. When they moved their weapons, it was one movement. When they saluted, it was one movement. They all marched in one direction. All these unique and wonderful individuals were one. That's what the body of Christ is like. They're inseparable as a unit. They're so unique and individual as separate beings. Number three, the breaking of bread. Now, this is not the Christian the contemporary practice of the bread and the cup that we celebrate in communion. There's no liturgical service that is going on in what they're talking about here. This is just folks sitting around the table, having a bite to eat, talking. But there's something holy, something sacred in that, just as it is. It's where deep relationships are formed. They hosted each other often, sincerely and graciously, and they rotated often so as not to burden one family or another. And it was around the table that the important discussions happened. They talked about the resources and offerings, helping the needy, discuss the family's future. All of these things happen sitting there at the dinner table together. It's where intimacy with others who love God manifested in deepening discipleship. It was a It's a holy thing. It is a holy thing. And bodies are fed, yes. But when the body of Christ gets together and shares a meal with each other at one another's home, then souls are fed as well. Number four is prayers. Now, these were definitely a people of prayer. They prayed fervently about everything. We've grown up in a time when Christianity has predominance in the world. Now, it's a blessing that Christianity is strong enough to be able to affect great change in the world and be able to address the needs of many in this world. But the danger comes when we fail to ask if at times we become dependent on our material abilities and capabilities. And if we're not lifting up our needs to God like we should, if we're not asking Jesus for his input in our decision making, if we're not giving God authority over our lives. Now, they were a small minority then. They had no political or economic or social sway like we're used to. They prayed fervently because God was all the strength and resource that they had. But what they received for that was a deep and intimate, a powerful relationship with the Lord. And the good news is that, you know, you can share that relationship, that same one that they had, if you'll turn to prayer for your spiritual exercise as well. You can share that same relationship with God and with one another that they so cherished, if you'll turn to the breaking of bread with each other and with fellowship. Now, this is not new information. I'm not giving y'all any innovative ideas that are cooked up in some university or a corporate think tank. This is the same stuff that y'all have grown up knowing. These are the same things y'all have heard over and over. We have a habit of going through life wanting to know the next new thing, wanting to know the next big thing, how we can apply it to our lives, when what we need to do is learn how to apply what we already know. Saying that we're Christian rolls so easily off the tongue. But doing the things that manifest Christ in us, the fellowship, the teaching, the worship, the breaking of the bread, the prayers, well, those things, they really throw a wrench in our plans for the day, don't they? Now, see, the troubles of this world, they're going to fade one day. And when that happens, we'll be standing in front of the infinite one. And we'll see that he's been holding out an invitation to us the entire time. Isn't he worth our time too? Shouldn't we be spending time with the one that we say we want to spend eternity with? No. saying that I'm a Christian doesn't mean I follow Christ. I can stand in the garage and honk till my lungs give out. But if I don't drive, then a car I am not. Jesus said, if I don't do the works, don't believe a thing I say. But if I do them, then, well, all were in awe of the apostles because they were doing the works. Christ did the works because he was in the Father and the Father was in him. The apostles did the works because they were in Christ and Christ was in him. And the Holy Spirit. And you have that same Holy Spirit in you. You are gifted for this ministry. You are equipped for this mission. People will be in awe of God in your life if you are living in God the way that they were at the formation of the church. They'll be drawn to you, to the light that's shining out of you, the light of Jesus Christ, who's turning the community of faith into a city on the hill. We'll be closing our service today with number 348, Softly and Tenderly, Jesus is Calling. Can you hear him calling? Will you put him off? Or will you say now is not the time, or that you're not ready? Or will you answer with an open heart? Will you say that you're ready?
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home, you who are weary, come home. Calling, oh sinner, come home. Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me? Why should we linger when he not his mercies, mercies for you and for me? Come home. Come home. Come home, earth. you
and for me.
Come home,
come home,
come home.
You
are weary, come
home.
Earnestly, tenderly,
Jesus is calling,
calling,
O sinner, come home.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the joy of being in your presence today, Lord. Continue to let your presence linger with us as we go from here. Father, grow your spirit in us as we grow in you. May your bounty just pour out of us and your grace flow from us upon all that we meet. And may all be blessed by you in our paths. In your most precious name we pray. Amen.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kin.